church say amen.
Amen.
For a day in thy courts,
uh-huh,
is better than a thousand elsewhere.
Yeah. All right.
I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. I say to you, good morning, good morning, good afternoon, good afternoon, I mean, good afternoon. Truly it is a blessing to be here this day.
Amen.
This day. What a mighty God we serve.
Amen.
What a mighty God we serve.
Amen.
You know, it wasn't because we were so good. It's not because we are so righteous.
Amen.
But it is because of God's grace.
Yeah.
And His new mercy.
Yeah.
That He gives us each and every day.
Yeah.
Each and every day.
Yeah.
And we do have something to be thankful for.
Amen.
So thankful for. I truly thank my God and my Savior.
Amen.
For allowing me to stand before you once again.
Amen.
Once again. Amen. Once again.
Amen.
Hold up your right hands and point it towards
All right.
Sister Tanisha.
All right.
And tell her, Sister Tanisha.
Sister Tanisha.
Preach.
Sister Tanisha.
Sister Tanisha.
Preach.
Preach.
Sister Tanisha.
Sister Tanisha.
Let God use you.
Let God use you.
This morning. First of all, I want to give honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for truly apart from Him, I really can do nothing. And I want to say good morning to the shepherd of the church, Reverend Lewis, and to also my little brother in the ministry, Demarcus Ayler, and to my husband, my partner, my friend, my brother in the ministry, to Brother Keith Robinson. And to all of our ushers, good morning. And to all of St. John, good morning.
Amen.
Good morning.
Today, I'm going to go to Hebrews. Hebrews 13, verse 20 through 21. That is Hebrews, verse 20 through 21. And your verse is on the program as well. And when you have it, please say amen. Now, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Our theme for this morning is the heart of a true servant.
My.
I will be using for the title of this message, Keep the Faith. Keep the faith. The book of Hebrews was written to Jewish Christians and Gentiles who had been previously drawn to the Jewish religion. This book of the Bible could also be considered to be a sermonic letter. The author of Hebrews remains unknown to this day. The author reminds his recipients of Christ's superiority to any angel, priests, or old covenant institution. He encourages the Christians to continue to persevere in the faith,
yes,
in the midst of persecution and various trials that many believers were facing.
Yes.
Some believers may have stopped coming to church. Hebrews 10:24-25 says, and let us consider how to stir one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day drawing near. Some believers were still infants in their faith. Hebrews 5:12-13 says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food.
Right.
For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness,
right,
since he is a child.
Yeah, yeah.
There were believers thrown into prison, and believers who were also being mistreated.
Yeah.
The author also encouraged believers to not be led away by strange and diverse teachings.
Yeah.
The author also gave several warnings to believers about the result of not keeping the faith. He reminded believers in Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. The same message that was given to the Christians way back then is the same message given to us today. God is the same today, yesterday, and forever. God is urging us to keep the faith. Like the believers then, we are also facing various trials in our life. We face sickness of our loved ones, sickness in our own bodies. We have aches and pains that the Lord will not remove. For the Lord tells us, my grace is sufficient. Sometimes it seems as if no matter how much, how long, and how often we pray, the difficulties seem to get worse and better. We face marital problems. We face the challenge of raising kids in a world filled with evil. Our kids face bullying and peer pressure on a daily basis. Every news station is a barrier for bad news, more killing, more violence, more destruction, and so on. We face problems in our families, in the church, on our jobs, and as a result of the various trials that we face, many believers stop coming to church, and some also draw away from God instead of close to Him. And just like God warned the believers of the danger of falling away, God also warned us today to keep the faith. Hebrews 10:38 says, but my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. Hebrews 12:29 says, for our God is a consuming fire. There are three things that we need to remember in order to keep our faith. Hebrews 13:21 says, equip you with everything good that you may do his will. The word equip means to supply with the necessary items for a particular purpose. The one who is doing the equipping is well qualified, for he's considered the great shepherd of the sheep by the blood of the eternal covenant. He is the one who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despised the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. He is seated far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name that is named. He is considered the Alpha and Omega. He is considered the head of the church. There are a few things that Christ has given to us to equip us. Number one, God has given us prayer to equip us to do his will. John 14:13-14 says, whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you have a problem, talk to the one who's a problem solver. He will provide us with whatever we stand in need of. We must always remember, our help comes from the Lord. Number two, God has given us his word to equip us to do his will. For 2 Timothy 3 chapter 16-17 verse says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, and for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. We must remember to draw near to God through his word also. His word is considered living and active. His word has the power to build us up and comfort us. And then number three, God allows trials to equip us to do his will. James 1:2-4 says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. We will have the steadfastness or endurance to carry out the work of God in the midst of opposition. We are not excused from suffering. God allowed his only son to suffer death on the cross for our sake. Hebrews 4:15 says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. We too must suffer for the sake of others. Our trials allow us to be able to sympathize with the needs of others. The next part of the verse, which says, equip you with everything that you may do this will, the next part says, working in us, which means that the tools of prayer, the Word of God, and the trials God uses to equip us allows God to work in us, which means the next part of verse says, that which is pleasing in His sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So after that, the result in our life is the good fruit that God sees Amen. Through our actions, Amen. Which means that the fruit of love, patience, and kindness is produced in our actions. We begin to love more. We begin to show more concern for the needs of others. And all of this leads to pleasing God and bringing glory Amen. To His name.
Amen.
I encourage you this morning to keep the faith.
Yeah.
Truly, our God is truly faithful.
Amen.
I've learned that the Lord, He equips me to do His will. I've learned to call on Him in the good times and in the bad times.
Amen.
I've learned to call on Him for everything.
Yes.
I've learned to say, Lord, I need you.
Yeah.
To help me be a good wife.
Yeah.
Lord, I need you help me to be a good mother.
Yeah.
Help me in teaching them your way.
Yeah.
I've learned to say, Lord, I need you on my job.
Yeah.
Help me to provide good patient care so that you are glorified.
Yeah.
I've learned to say, Lord, I've been asked to preach your word this Sunday.
Yeah.
So I need a word. And remember, you are the one who called me to preach.
Yeah.
And by the way, will you give me the word before 3 o'clock? Because I have a birthday party that I'm trying to get to. And he did it too. You had it out because you asked not.
That's right.
Lord, I need your help teaching the beginner's class today. You know we got new review next Sunday, so we need some help.
Yeah.
Lord, I need your help doing children's church. Help me, Lord. Lord, and then I also learned to turn to His word in the good times and the bad times.
Right.
When I need wisdom, comfort, or strength, I've learned to turn to Romans 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose. Or Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not walk. He makes me lie down in green pastures. Psalms 121, I lift up my eyes to the hill. Where is my help coming? And sometimes, when I'm really confused about the chaos that's going on in my life, I may go to Isaiah 55:8, but my thoughts are not.
Yeah.